In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. I've been in Kentucky fishing 18 years now. But I just learned Saturday a week ago how long the little girls' softball tournaments last in Kentucky. Chloe is our 8-year-old granddaughter, little blonde. She's come to church with us from time to time here. She's the little athlete of our family. Saturday a week ago, I went to her tournament. It started at 10 in the morning, and at 7:30 at night, they were still playing softball. Of course, part of that had a little to do with Kentucky and everything to do with the fact that they kept winning, which is a good thing. If it seemed long to me, then you can imagine how long it seemed to little Carson. Carson is Chloe's little 5-year-old brother. And Carson is right in the middle of the peppering age. You know what the peppering age is. You may call it something different, but you know what it is. That age that children get into where you, when in their company, are peppered with questions at a maximum of every 60 seconds. The lights came on toward the evening as it got dark at the softball game. The stadium lights came on, and Carson looked up and he said, "Poppy," that's me, Poppy. He said, "Poppy, why do they turn those lights on?" And I said, "Well, just so we can see that, keep seeing the game." Reasonable answer. But those of you familiar with the peppering phase know that it doesn't ever end there. Then he said, "Well, Bobby, why is that light white and that light orange?" You're peppered with questions every 60 seconds, most of which no human being can answer. But at least Carson is honestly seeking answers. You know, at 5 years old, the world is his oyster. He just doesn't quite know how it all works yet. So he comes to us to shed some light on it. We all, as children, go through the peppering age. And we're under the illusion that we grow out of it. We don't. It's just that the questions change. And even more ominous, the intent of our questions sometimes change. The disciples' questions to Jesus about this blind man, rather than seeking answers about his blindness, their questions really reveal only that it is they who are the blind ones. You notice that in these questions, the disciples never asked Jesus if sin was responsible for this man's condition, but rather they just want to know who it was that did sin. Was it him or his mom and dad? So Jesus shed some light on it for them and told them, "This man's not blind because anyone sinned. He's blind so that I can show who I am." You know, John's gospel is also called the fourth gospel and sometimes the book of signs, so as to distinguish it from the other three. And the reason that John's gospel is different from the other three is because John's purpose is very different from the other three. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, as you know, commonly called the synoptic gospels, are all very similar in their language, in their conversations, and in their time. The chronology is very same. Some places identical. Those Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they tell us a chronology of what Jesus did. But John's Gospel deals almost exclusively, not with what Jesus did so much, but it deals with who Jesus was. In fact, John's Gospel starts off, it sounds a lot like Genesis, in the beginning, because John wants us to know that Christ was God. That's the purpose of his gospel. And John, including this particular mirror, accords perfectly then with his purpose of showing us that God and Christ are the same. Jesus spits on the ground and mixes his saliva with clay, anoints this man's eyes with it, and tells him, "Now go wash in the pool at Siloam." And he did. And he came back seeing. It's important to note, though, this man's sight was not restored, because this man had always been blind. He was blind from birth, which means, if you think about it, that the cells and the tissues and the nerves and the neurons and the synapses, all that stuff that I have no understanding of, all those things that give us sight didn't exist in this man. Which in turn means that they were created, miraculously created, where none previously existed. It's almost like Jesus is saying, "I'm still here, and I'm eternal. I'm still the creator. I can still create something from nothing. I can still even create life from nothing, and I can still create it from clay." Just like in the beginning. John so wants us to know this. In fact, he starts the prologue to his gospel. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." This poor blind man, who had never even seen his own face, had just been given sight. And yet, he was denied the opportunity to relish and savor the joy of what had to be the most magical moment of his life. Talk about being peppered with questions. Little Carson would have trouble keeping up with these folks. This man was subjected to a deluge of questions, a veritable interrogation, if you will. Not just him, both he and his parents. It's almost as though he had done something wrong. The intent of their questions was not to have any light shed on this miraculous blessing, but rather to elicit from him a condemnation of Jesus, from whom he had just received his sight. One of the great literary minds of the 18th century hails from Edinburgh, Scotland, in the UK, in the person of Robert Louis Stevenson. Robert Louis Stevenson produced some great classics, and no young man that grew up in my age did not read Treasure Island, Robert Louis Stevenson. He also did many other great works, including Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. But Robert Louis Stevenson is told by experts of literature, which I'm not, that Robert Louis Stevenson had this uncanny ability to observe what everyone else was observing, yet see it differently. And his book, Kidnapped, this is very evident. If you read Kidnapped, it reads like an adolescent, boyish adventure story. Yet, this book is based on murder. Google it, you'll find it. In 1700 in Scotland, the Appin murder took place, and it would be akin to the O.J. trial in our time, where everyone, not just in Scotland, probably most of the U.K., were talking about this thing. And everyone observed it, everyone knew the details of it, including Robert Louis Stevenson, but he saw it differently. And he wove it into this marvelous story of sea travel and sea battles, mutiny and betrayal of all sorts of skullduggery. Robert Louis's parents said that Robert Louis always had this ability, and they tell the story of the time they walked in and saw him in an open window looking down at the cobblestone streets of Edinburgh and just standing there. And they stopped and watched and waited and thinking, you know, how long is he going to do this? And they kind of became fixated on him being fixated. And finally, as some time went by, the dad couldn't take it any longer, so he walks up to him and he said, what on earth are you so fascinated with out this window? And Robert Lewis said, look at that guy. And the dad looked down and he said, son, that's the lamplight. And in those days, as dark approached, they had this guy that would go along the cobblestone streets with his little ladder. And he had this little torch contraption, and he leaned the ladder up on the sides of the dwellings along the streets, climb up, light the lamp, come back down, and go on to the next. And his dad said, that's just the lamplight. He's just lighting the lamps. And Robert Lewis said, no, Dad, look at him. He's punching holes in the darkness. Punching holes in the darkness. The Lord in today's gospel reading warned us that the darkness would come, both in his day and in ours. And it does. And it has. Let me ask you a question. How many of you have ever come home from work or whatever you're doing during the day for lunch and you come in on a bright, sunshiny day, straight up noon, and eat lunch, and you go back out and you open the door and it's pitch midnight black dark? Never happened to me either. That's because the darkness comes slowly in shadows. Comes suddenly. It comes so slowly and so suddenly it's unnoticeable until we are enveloped in it. Jesus is not talking about daytime and nighttime darkness. He's talking about spiritual darkness. Sometimes, to see how far in the darkness we have wandered, we should question our questions. The Pharisees, you see, that questioned this blind man were not inherently evil people. In fact, they thought and sincerely believed they were doing God's work. They didn't even know they were in the dark. The Lord's warning about coming darkness and the things I say to you today can be discouraging. We all want to think, I know I do, we all want to think everything's fine in the world. It isn't. And Jesus in today's gospel reading tells us the night is coming when no one can work. And when he says work, he's not talking about plumbing and pouring concrete. He's talking about the spiritual work of the kingdom. The shadows are falling quickly on the Western world. You can go to Europe and go on tours and see these majestic cathedrals. Just awe-inspiring. They have tours, they'll take you to them. And they're all over the place in Europe. Europe is old. These are just mind-boggling architectural monuments to God. Places that fed the souls. Standing room only church services for centuries. And as you stand outside and look at them, you will just be awestruck. But if you enter them, you will see they are essentially empty. Many, in fact, are now museums. And the purpose they serve now is historical rather than spiritual. If you include Scandinavia, in Europe, 1 in 20 go to church at all, much less regularly. In England itself, 1 in 10 is seriously involved in the life of the church. England, the mother country, as Anglicans, it should not only sadden our hearts to hear that, but it should set off all of our spiritual alarm systems. 1 in 10 in the country that gave us John Newman, Thomas Cranmer, Wycliffe and Tinsdale and Queen Elizabeth and Anne Boleyn, and on. In Europe, Christianity is spoken of openly in the past tense. And the question in the minds of many, if not most, is not how did this happen, but rather the question is, isn't it good that that nonsense is behind us? It's not just England, not just Europe. In the U.S. last year, over 1 million women destroyed their own children in their own womb. And the question, by many, if not most, is not, why did you do that? The question in the minds of many is, why do you hate women and we deny them health care? And before we church-going folk get high-minded, as we have a tendency to do from time to time, the question we would often ask these women is, how could you do that? Rather than, what can I do to bring you into the sunshine of God's forgiveness that you may find peace? In direct defiance of God's instructions that all sexual activity outside of holy matrimony is sinful, man in his vast wisdom and intellect now says otherwise. Thank you very much, God. And even seeing the undeniable facts of the last few decades of how lethal that view has been to children, to families, to society, still the question asked is not, how can we return to the safety and stability of God's natural laws? But rather, the question is, what bigoted, old-fashioned rock did you crawl out from under? Yeah, we think that we grow out of the peppering age. But the Pharisees in today's gospel reading are proof we don't. It's just questions and their intent change. With an honest questioning of my questions, I can reveal to myself how far into the shadows I am. Is the intent of my questions about life honestly to punch holes in the darkness, or is it to impress you and boost my ego? Is the intent of my questions about life, are they really geared to find the light spoken of in all the scripture readings today? Or is my real intent to prove you wrong and me right, so I can proudly put on my white hat and walk away? Is the intent of my questions about life really to punch holes in the darkness? Or are they really intended to deceive you, to bait you into my scheme, and use you to further my agenda? Jesus, in today's gospel reading, says, the night is coming, and it did. And his warnings of that, and what I've said to you this morning, can be discouraging. Can drop our moves to rock bottom. But we must remember this also. Jesus also said in this gospel reading, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And I can tell you for a fact, Jesus is still in the world. In fact, I saw him this morning. I see him in you. He dwells in us. And may he, through us, continue to punch holes in the darkness. And to facilitate that, let us from time to time question our questions about life. And may we at least occasionally ask ourselves this fundamental question. When I am in the dark, do I even know it? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.